Okay, Chester, aside from the executive order, the president also released a strongly worded statement against China last week, particularly on Monday, Thursday. The president says that he has informed the Philippines' allies of the country's requirements, its particular needs to protect and secure its sovereignty, sovereign rights, and jurisdiction in the West Philippine Sea. Give us a picture of what kinds of equipment or vessels Manila needs to effectively deter Beijing's aggression in the West Philippine Sea.
Okay. We heard strong words from our president, very consistent since he was elected as our leader. And we could sense that there is a strategic really in our external defense before looking at the requirements for the deterrence of our armed forces. Let's look also at their doctrine and strategies right now, because as we are talking right now, of course, the AFP and of course the DND are changing their strategies to territorial defense, and to lately we have the comprehensive articulated defense that looks at the external security threat. And the mere fact that our president also signed the National Security Policy 2023 to 2028, which is an outward looking national security policy, the first time that the Philippines has this kind of a policy, security policy that looks beyond the terrestrial domain of the Philippines, but looking at the maritime domain also of the country, the archipelago state. Now, what are the requirements for the naval exercises in defense of the country? This is part of the project of the AFP modernization, where of course the core requirement is to enhance, beef up, and strengthen the naval and aerial capabilities of the armed forces. Definitely, we will be needing large vessels, ironclad vessels, also for resupply missions. I know that compared to our counterparts, our aggressors, we have bigger and larger vessels. Sometimes we form fortress formation, but I think our counter in that kind of strategy by our aggressor is the intuition towards alliances and partnerships. The reason why we are forming alliances and strategic partnerships with like-minded democratic countries is to foster this collective deterrence that the giant neighbor is imposing towards us. So it's not only by having all those rigid and strong vessels and aircraft, but I think more than that is the strategy and the execution of this strategy. Remember, in all wars and conflicts that we have seen, sometimes even if you have the most sophisticated technology, and you have outnumbered the enemy, that doesn't mean that you will win. What is important here is that we have to synchronize, we have to think of interoperability, frankness. That's the reason why we are having military exercises with our allies and partners in order for us to exercise and execute the kind of strategy that we wanted for the West Philippines to. And of course, to other American
Philippines. Okay, Chester, before we talk about strategy that the Philippines will likely employ in the next few weeks, let's first talk about the disparity between Beijing and Manila's naval forces, or maritime assets at that. How wide is the disparity? I'm not sure if you have data on hand right now, but can you give us at least an idea as to how much the difference is when it comes to the spending of the two nations, when it comes to their maritime assets?
Well, of course, let's talk about the budget. Definitely, the People's Liberation Army has bigger chunk of budget compared to the Philippines. And compared to us, we have to ask permission from Congress to approve our budget, unlike in the People's Liberation Army Navy. It's the military that has the control in terms of their expenditure. I think last night I was looking at some of the assets that China has. And definitely, they have a bigger, how would I say it, destroyers compared to the Philippines. I think in terms of, we have to admit that in terms of modernization now, we have outpaced even Western standards in their naval, imperial, and terrestrial assets. So they are number one in the number of vessels. But of course, if we combine all the assets of our friends and allies, then I think that is a game changer for the people. Because, like, say, for example, you have the United States, Japan, Australia, and the European Union who are willing to help us. If you combine all their assets, naval assets, they definitely will outnumber the vessels and aircraft of, and the courier of China right now. And also, our friends and allies have World War experiences. We have combat experiences, unlike China, which we have not yet seen any World War or combat experience that they have undertaken. So if a shooting war happens, then I think our friends and allies, and of course the Philippines, since the Second World War, it came into Vietnam and Korean Wars, and then 6 years ago we had the Marawi siege. I think our military are well prepared for combat operation. I think that we have to exercise really this new territorial defense that the AFP and the government trying to pronounce right now, because I think for the longest time we have focused on the internal security. This time around, it's on our responsibility, for our full responsibility, to act as the lead actor and the main leader in this kind of strategy that we are forging.
Okay, Chester, since you already mentioned the possibility of war and combat, the president also said in that statement during Maundy Thursday that in the succeeding weeks, the Philippine government shall implement a countermeasure package that is proportionate, deliberate, and reasonable. Quite vague there, as operational details should be. But what are your sources telling you? What should we actually brace for in the coming weeks?
Oh, well, of course, we know that there is an upcoming TV meeting between the presidents of the Philippines, Japan, and the United States. This is the first of its kind, like a tour de force of maritime powers in the South China Sea. And definitely, we have to look at our expectations. The meets and bounds of our report, of our boundaries, our domain, and of course, what do we expect with our report? Because we are partnering with a superpower and a great power like the U.S. and Japan. I think what the president is saying there is that let's also look at our expectations and what we can offer in this bilateral meeting. And hopefully, the reason I think the intention of this to build a stronger collective alliance and to campaign for the maritime rules norm, so that China, if convinced with this norm, will also be pacified to follow legal and non-aggressive order and rules and regulations. Of course, right now in the South China Sea, what we can see here, we have no rules engagement in terms of current conflict, and many of the norms of war that we have known are Eurocentric. This is the first time that in case this will be first talked about, there will be a benchmark case on how we would try to foster the fundamental right to live in peace and freedom, and of course to foster for that freedom from fear of violence and threat, which China is trying to show to the region because of its constant resistance so far. That's the reason why it should be appropriate and regulated at the same time, so that we know what would be the contributions of these allies and partners. And at the same time, we have to calculate also the strength of China, because of course we don't want to underestimate also China's military power and its naval strategy right now. But based from the comparative analysis of these many maritime powers that we are looking at, I think we are in the right direction of partnering with the seasoned maritime powers like the United States, Japan, and other like-minded countries that have worldwide experiences, stronger strategy, and definitely someone we can rely on.
Okay, Chester, before we jump into the trilateral summit happening in Washington, D.C. next week, let's first try to break down the technical jargon for ordinary Filipinos here. When the president says that a countermeasure package that is proportionate, deliberate, and reasonable, when he says that, what does that actually mean for ordinary Filipinos on the ground? Are we expecting a counter-water cannon attack, or is it simply a play of words, or is it simply rhetoric here? What do you expect?
Very good. Yeah, very good clarification there. Well, of course, when he mentioned about that, I think the Philippines will not go to what China has been doing also. We will not also resort to violence and aggression in terms of doing water cannon or using light war or other reason tactics. I think what the president would mean here is that, of course, we would still regard our strength in terms of law here. I think the legalist approach of the Philippines is very sophisticated, that we were able to enlighten the world with the use of the legal approach. And secondly, when he mentioned about that, he also would like to boost the confidence of our armed forces, particularly those frontliners like the Navy and Coast Guard, and of course the Air Force also, because when we do external defense, the Navy and Air Force are important in your territorial defense. So partly, he is also saying that he will do everything under his leadership to support the armed forces by abiding to the UNCLOS award that we have won in 2016. At the same time, you have to widen your diplomatic clout. That's the reason why our president is in for bilateral summits and other multilateral engagements, like-minded countries, so that he would still maintain the kind of diplomacy, and we would also not resort to any violence, because the reason why he signed the new executive order number 67 last Sunday is to at least tell to the world that we are a country that favor the fundamental right to live in peace and freedom. And of course, that's the reason why he signed the law, in order for us to strengthen our armed forces and other defense and security sectors to become instrumental to free us from fear of violence. I think that was the main intention of that. And in layman's term, I think he is in for freedom from fear of violence and threat. I think we have to consider those words in such a way that the president will not tolerate such barbaric and violent acts, just like what our giant neighbor has been doing to us. The Philippines will not resort to any brazen tactic like a water cannon, because we have shown since 2012 when China hired us with the water cannons, we did not resort to any kind of force. Instead, we showed them the most diplomatic way, the use of rules-based norms, and of course, we have shown them how diplomatic the Filipinos are.
Okay, so we are still on a wait-and-see mode on how the Philippines will actually play its cards in mounting its new Aurora mission in the West Philippine Sea, as well as on how it will actually deal with China's incursions when that happens. But Chester, before we let you go, I know that you already talked extensively about your expectations with regard to the trilateral summit in Washington, D.C. next week. The president is, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., is expected to meet there, U.S. President Joe Biden, as well as Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida. We all know that the Philippines is one of the first recipients of Japan's official security assistance framework. Any chance that that agreement or that assistance could actually be expanded during Marcos's and Kishida's meeting next week?
Yes. Thanks for highlighting the OSK or the official security between Japan and the Philippines. I think that's a distinct cooperation between these two Asian countries. We have not seen that before, although, of course, we have been a recipient of the ODA or the official development aid of Japan in terms of our infrastructure program. I think if this will succeed in terms of the of implementation on the OSK, I think this will also be used by other countries in terms of how they will support the defense and or the national security infrastructure of the system. I know that there will be, aside from the trilateral meeting of these three countries in Washington next month, this month, this April, by November, there will be a game-changing presidential elections also in Washington, in the USA. We still do not know if Biden will retain his presidency, if he proposed the IPEF or the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework, which also would help the Philippines in terms of its defense and national security infrastructure. I don't know if Trump wins and he will consider of continuing kind of framework, but we do not know still yet. But nonetheless, I think the OSA between the Philippines and Japan is a very distinct groundbreaking military act in terms of distance. Japan has been helping us in terms of our coastal defense through the Philippine Coast Guard, and this time around, he really wanted to help also the armed forces, particularly the Navy. That's the reason why you have the OSC. I think that will be considered in terms of the how wide the parameters of other aid and support to the Philippines. Let's see what happens by the April 11th when the full leadership is aside from speaking also President Biden.
And we will have to leave it at that for now. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, security analyst Dr. Chester Cabalza.